usual, I don't have a manuscript when I play. I play by ear, but due to timing and my bad English, I had a teacher in Mo I Rana 50 years ago, and he when talking about would we like clock and what's the time? He said, "How plenty is the bell?" I'd rather stick to this paper and try to read as good as I can. As a member of the planning committee for this summit, or for me rather a symposium, drink and discuss, I am honored to introduce and welcome you to this gathering, which focus is on different aspects and perspectives on the music and cultural expression still called jazz. As an introduction, I will give some general and personal reflections on jazz, which has had great impact on music, society and education during the last century, and still is a vital expression with great diversity around the globe. A short little historical statement. The first time the word jazz was seen in print seems to be in 1913, when a sports journalist, Peter Tamony, used the word about a powerful baseball player. The writer Walter Kingsley claims that the word jazz is of African origin and was transplanted to New Orleans surroundings. The meaning of the word was to speed up things, a common expression among West Africans on the days off, with singing, dance and drumming was jazz her up, which was a signal of understand physical dance and fun, often with connotation to sexual activity. Later in 1915, white musicians like the trombone player Tom Brown named this music and bands for jazz band, signifying sexual intercourse band, because of their connection to the bordello activity. And it's interesting that in Molde have this old jazz. I don't know if they know what really it's mean jazz, sexual intercourse. Oil festival in Malta. With such an exciting, highly mixed start on this now 100 years old story, it's quite natural to meet here in Trondheim and try to understand and discuss part of this music's actuality and relevance in the first part of the 21st century. In these days, it's 50 years since I started my jazz career in my hometown Mo I Rana in the northern part of Norway. During these 50 years, half of the history of jazz, oh my God, I have had one foot in the jazz community as a jazz basis, and the other foot in the musicology and jazz educational community. This kind of schizophrenic existence has been interesting, but sometimes hard to cope with, especially my feeling of negative and condescending attitudes towards jazz from part of the musicology and also society in general, particularly in my early years as a jazz musician and academic in the late 60s and early 1970s. Today, jazz is generally well accepted and included in both society and education the world over. However, I'm not sure if the full human potential of this cultural expression has been given the ultimate possibilities for development. I wonder if this way of communication is fully understood and recognized even in the jazz community, as an important element in sharing experience, knowledge, and emotion in a globalized, demanding, and challenging world. Talking about the human potential of this music, jazz, I'm referring to the interactional, face-to-face action, especially the social and learning aspects that unfold during the course of performance in real time. My main interest in my academic life in that regard as a jazz musician and ordinary member of society has been to investigate and try to understand the phenomenon improvisation, which is a part of all musics studied and one which is one of the main and strongest characteristics of jazz. In this short inaugural, it is no time to elaborate on this issue. However, for those interested, a copy of one of my articles on improvisation is available at the Secretary Office. Times have changed through 100 years with jazz and the new technologies. The world has got smaller and as people we seem closer connected. But at the same time, it's also a fragmented and threatening world. As I see jazz today, It is a strong and important music that is globally interrelated, sharing common knowledge and language, but with different dialects all over the world. I don't believe there exists something like pure Norwegian or Swedish jazz, Italian or Brazilian jazz. For me, this gives me kind of protectionist and nationalistic association. I would say we rather have jazz in Norway, Sweden, Russia, Germany. In other words, jazz as a common international language, which gives hope for fruitful collaboration and interaction. Our most renowned jazz musician during the last 40, 50 years, Jan Garbarek, said in the late 1990s, "What I'm playing today, whatever it is, I'm playing because I once learned the language of jazz. But we also have our blues equivalents, our own folk music." Other of my generation's jazz musicians, John Christensen, Bobo Stenson, Polly Danielson, who have all made great success with so-called new European jazz, have all of them learned the language of jazz. They respect and fully appreciate their African American influence on as very important, and which led the ground for using their own country's musical roots in a creative and innovative way. I think this musician's humble attitude pinpoints the important and now happening connection between the local and the global, in globalization terms called glocalization. Europe has in the last decade been focused as creating the new, exotic and innovative jazz. Some voices claim that the reason for this development is the combination of European classical music and jazz. The generalization European classical music and jazz are concepts that are not quite easy to deal with. It's fine if there are mutual inspirations going on between these categories, but to me there are crucial differences between the great music, this great musical expression, especially when it comes to education. A short example, which I've taken for Peter J. Martin's book, I guess he is here. The way a classical saxophone player is trained is to produce a pure, impersonal tone, acting as a medium for a composer's intention, while a jazz saxophonist is striving for achieving an individual voice, for attaining a distinct, recognizable, personal musical identity. As far as I know, classical training in European conservatories is still very traditional, and much of the jazz training is using classical methods. Here in Trondheim, we seem to use learning methods that in different ways deviate from many European conservatories, which Erling, my colleague Erling Akstad, will talk about later. Who has the right to define what jazz is and is not? I dare not try to answer this difficult and complex question, but rather give some quotes from two persons who emphasize qualities that I find actual and relevant when dealing with jazz, and not at least on background of what challenges our world in these days are facing: financial crisis, religious antagonism, and extreme gap between poor and rich. In 1999, there was a TV interview, probably recorded in the 50s, celebrating Duke Ellington's centennial anniversary. Duke was asked about his relationship to his people. "My people," he said, he answered, and he played some blues licks, and he then continued, "Which of my people? You know, I am in several groups." And he obviously searched to find the right words for an answer to this difficult question. He was improvising. After naming the different groups he belonged to, piano players, dilettantes, experts, and many more, he concluded, "I also have had such strong influence by the music of the people, that's the better word, the people rather than my people. The people are my people." This including solidarity attitude and spirit of community is somewhat similar to what Desmond Tutu expresses with his South African term Ubuntu. He says, "A person is a person through other persons. It is not I think, therefore I am. It says rather, I am human because I belong. I participate, I share." Today, Ellington and Tutu's focus on the including aspects of belonging, participating and sharing might have been expressed, for example, of the Norwegian Stian Karstensen or Bulgarian Trifon Trifonov from Farmers Market, or anyone from the jazz community the world around. Let's focus on matter that unite rather than split, and use this occasion and our common efforts to strengthen creation, education, distribution, and joy in and for this music. Let's argue roughly and fair, hot and cool, and let's keep swinging, improvise, and have fun in a friendly way. Welcome to you all.